My name is Todd Fitz. I teach in New York. I'm at 90 miles north of New York City at a private boarding school. I'm the first time I'm here, so represent. And you told me this would be awesome, and it is. Starting my time, I'm going to talk about 3D printing in my classroom. So a couple 3D printers showed up at our school, so my steps were appropriate one and then figure out how to use it. And I looked at a lot of different things, and what I came up with is using Wolfram Mathematica. This is their Twitter handle. If you feel moved to tweet about this, and you feel also moved to tag them, it might be good for them to know that we would like access up to this, so that they'll be, I'm having some conversations with them about making this more accessible. So, this is part, I have a proposal to speak about this at NCTM. I hope to compress that down to 10 minutes. What I think I really did is put it in a blender. So you're not going to see the sequencing that I use. I'm just going to show you what I do, and you can fill in the blanks, which I'm really confident about having done a lot of it. So here's a quick list of questions that I'm not going to answer. Oh, you got it, Kate.
Oh, no.
That's going to be a problem.
Post it on Twitter later?
It's kind of my whole thing. It's all okay. As I was saying, there's some questions I won't answer. Are you crossing your fingers?
Sounds off. Yeah. 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 Yeah.
So, quick lesson. So this is the one command to use. Now, Mathematica is a robust, huge program. We use this one thing, it's region plot 3D. And basically, we're plotting systems of inequalities in three-dimensional space. So if you look at, you have the first section, which are the six equations, and I'll let you think about what shape this is gonna make. Then you have the window here with the brackets. You have the axis label that will just label X, Y, and Z. And then you have plot points, which is your resolution on the screen, okay? So anybody can see what it's going to make?
Cube.
People?
A cube.
A cube, right. So there's the cube, and I'm just going to show you how the program looks when the cube gets rendered. You can spin it around and look at it. This is always a little thrilling for the students. It's thrilling for me. I like to rotate things. Mm-hmm. I used to have U masters when I was a kid. Okay, so here's the second one. I'm just going to show you, the sequencing is out. This is not the order I do things in. I'm going to show you one that I like, the use of this. So we have, I changed the equations here. So you have about 5 seconds to tell me what you think that's going to be.
Oh, Lord.
I just turned on.
It's a cylinder.
Okay, so we have an x, y, we have x squared plus y squared is less than 4 squared. So that's a circle with a radius of 4. In the xy direction now, so it goes on forever that way. And then the z is limited. Okay, so it's going to create a cylinder. All right, and I just wanted to do it from the beginning. We have the process and we render it, and there's the cylinder. Okay. Now the question is, can we make it a cone? Okay, and this is a process I really like. So if you think about it, if we take the cylinder and just change its radius as it drops up through Z, that'll create a cone. So this is my longest video, the heart of the program. So we're gonna take the cylinder, we're gonna create a cone there, and we see that the radius of the cone is a function of the Z. Okay, so we're gonna make a little table, and if Z is 0, which is down here, then the radius we want to be 4. If Z gets up to 6, and it doesn't quite go flat, because it's 3, the radius is 6, and then, I'm sorry, z is 6, then we want the radius to be 0. We want that relationship to be linear. So we're going to use a slope-intercept form, but with different variables. And it's not really what you're seeing there, because that's an xy scale. We're looking at r and z. And if you do the work, I'm sure you're already done in your head. we end up with a slope, and we end up with a y-intercept. And that's our new radius. And where that's going to have to go is up in our equation at the 4. Instead of that, we're going to replace that with that function. And now we've got an inequality in three variables that kids have made. You know, without sort of learning a formula, just sort of thinking about what a cone is. And that can be adaptable to making it come up like Hirsch's kiss, if we want to make it a parabola, and you pick three points and then use whatever regression tools you have, because we're using matrices to find the equation of a parabola, so there were pointing tools that they had that worked really nicely. And then here I just do it just to show you that work. So I just have to come back and replace it. It's a suspense building.
Yes.
It'll work. And then it renders and there's no so I mean it really is. Decimals in three directions. And every time I see someone from decimals, I see them in 3D. And it's actually. I asked him that. So here's some reasons why it's a favorite. Okay, when I'm doing this, the noise in the room, and you know this, is the telltale. They can't hide it. And the sounds move from agony to ecstasy. So when I introduce this, when we do different topics, I give them different challenges. So I didn't show you how to do. We can put an OR command in and have two objects sort of in one drawing. So that's one challenge. And these are kind of out of order. There's the Christmas presents. There's the fire hydrant. Okay, when we've done some circles. We can do a not command, which puts holes in things. And it's really just those things. It's a not and an or and an and. And then we have, I don't know, perpendicular circles, just ones I can find. There's another reason why I love it. It's open-ended persistence. Like any project you give, it's up to them to say when they're done. So this is David, who wanted to build a house. And you can see his equations. You can't really see what they are. They're pretty simple. They're mostly boxes. But he kept going. He wanted to build, I think it's the main school building. And it's really satisfying. And his math wasn't all so sophisticated, but he had to stick with it and get things sized. And he kept. You know, I think he built it without windows, and then he said, let me put in some windows, and then put on a chimney, and then it needs a deck. And then he was done, he said, he had other ideas, but he said, I gotta stop, which is, of course, the best. And then it allows for individual whimsy and creativity. So here's some examples of student work. Charlotte made a snowman. This one intimidated the heck out of everybody else. And this is the point, and I actually withheld this. I didn't want to show anybody else this. Until they had done their boxes with, you know, Christmas boxes they were stamped. But this is Jake's. And the other thing that was amazing is he said, I need to, what's the equation to a circle? I need to know this now, which of course, again, is the best. Here's some standard, just a group of things that they did. Aaron, I have to point out, Aaron was very proud of her man's butt. This is Jack. I had to design board games, and these were the game pieces of them. And Jack did a game about bridges. He's from New Jersey. And then Aria for pre-practice, but she had a trigonometric tail on the cat. And there's the printing. Now, these look really huge. This is Jake's dragon. Right? Of course, when you print 3D, you can print them to any scale that you like. So there's some examples, and there's the chair. You can see pretty simple, but satisfying. This was my favorite. We did refrigerator magnets. It's an assignment that's meant to go right on the refrigerator. Worth the price of admission right here. Okay. And again, you see sort of the variance about that. And actually, when we do a lot of vertical whiteboarding. So this year, my first project is going to be to make magnets so that we can stick things up on the board as we're doing that. So it's there. This was making calculus after the exam 2 years ago. I had them download the free version, a trial version, just for 2 weeks. And they each took a chess piece, and they made a chess piece just all out of equations. So this is, you can see challenges there. The knight, of course, is the most difficult. And So that sits in our schoolhouse lobby. So that was a, and then the last one is the wow, which is sometimes a kid does something. This is Jake again. So he wrote all these equations, and these are ellipses, and at this point in the year, in circles and parabolas and stuff. And he made a graph, which I'm holding here, which is like my little mascot now. Okay, so that was something. The bad news is that mathematics is not cheap. The 15-day free trial is something that I did, of course, in open the project, as I said. I did it for a year with just me having a copy. The programming isn't so bad. I mean, I have to switch some commas around and so on. Kids would come in and work with me. They email me their code in a Word document. And then there's a site license, which is pricey and confusing. But I'd give you their hashtag, their ad address, just to encourage you to let them know this would be a good thing for high school staff to have access to. But if you've got the printers, the software is so my goal here is to have somebody say, wow, I'd really like to know more about that. So I really want to talk about this. If you have colleagues who you want to contact me, that would be awesome. I'm going to do one last thing. I'm going to tweet this as we go. I'm going to play one game, which is pick the lowest number that nobody else picks, the lowest positive integer nobody else picks. So you'll see that tweet. I gave myself a PAN at the end of the TMC18, and I'll get you a dragon. But please talk to me. Thank you very much.